Hey guys, Merry Christmas! Last year I asked for some of my favorite franchises to come back, and much to my surprise, we did get a new F-Zero game, kind of, and a new Mega Man Battle Network game, sort of. So while I was wallowing in my own sadness at the time, we did end up getting some great games last year. This year, however, I've decided to temper my expectations a little bit by asking Santa-san for games that already exist and are definitely acquirable. And what better console to start with than the PS1? There were so many great, genre-defining games on the system, and some unusual ones. Many of these obscure games never left Japan, and I would really love to try them out myself. So today, we're gonna check out some of the weirdest Japanese games the PS1 has to offer. The first game we'll be taking a look at is Segare Ijiri, which at first glance looks like a kid's game, but the title literally means playing with yourself, or toying with it, or whatever the kids are saying these days. The game itself is very bizarre, and you play as a kid made from Gundam parts with an arrow for a head, and your mom is a severed cybernetic giraffe head. I cannot believe that was a sentence I just read out loud. You're placed in this side-scrolling area, and you can run and jump like a typical platformer. There are several characters and objects for you to interact with, and each one will give you a prompt, which lets you choose from a word bank, and you can make sentences with them. And the game will then show you an FMV sequence depicting whatever weird thing you chose. It's a cool concept, and it kind of feels like you're a kid going outside on an adventure and exploring new things and talking to strangers. Yay! And the more strangers you talk to, the more your mom's neck will get longer and allow you to level up. Leveling up gives you new things to help you traverse the world with, like vehicles. I said it like that because the first vehicle you get is a cow with a human face named Kuda. He lets you climb mountains, and the next one you unlock is a penguin, who lets you fly around and get to hard-to-reach areas. Your mom also occasionally gives you quests, but sometimes the directions can be unclear. And that's pretty much it. As simple as it is, I kinda started to like it the more I played it. It's just so unusual, you can't help but want to see more of what it has to offer. It's kinda like LSD Dream Emulator in that sense, and that also is a weird game. Graphically, it's a little simple, but I honestly think it looks pretty nice here. I always like it when developers decide not to push the limits of the hardware so much, and instead opt for something a little more clean and colorful. And I think that's why these early 3D games like this tend to age better than others. The one downside I found with this game, though, is that as you progress more, the new FMV sequences start getting replaced with still images. It's as if they spent most of their budget on the first 30 minutes of gameplay and then ran out of money for everything else. I'm guessing this is due to limited disk space at the time, but it's still unfortunate because I really would have loved to see more. Overall, this game was a lot better than I was expecting, and I'd easily recommend it to anyone to go check it out. Although the game is entirely in Japanese, so it may not be the most import-friendly game out there, but even then, I still think you'd be able to enjoy it because most of the fun comes from the cinematics, so I'm gonna give this game
3 stars.
The next game we're gonna be taking a look at is called Go For It, Morikawa-kun Mark II, but this one was localized in Europe as Pet in TV, and it was developed by the Jumping Flash team, so maybe it's pretty good. The game is all about these little guys, your pit robots. You choose one to play with and you're all set. The main gimmick of this game is that your robots are controlled entirely by AI, and you, the player, are observing and guiding them. Your robot will act on his own and interact with objects, and you can respond either approvingly or disapprovingly to teach him how he should behave in different situations. Thus, he will eventually be able to play the game by himself. As you can imagine, this involves a lot of trial and error, and it can be quite time-consuming, especially if there's a specific command you want him to do, like pick up an item and store it in his backpack. You'll have to cycle through all of his different actions until he finally does the right one, and then approve of it, and he'll remember it. But again, if you keep doing this over and over again, he'll eventually learn what to do, and this can lead to your robot being able to solve puzzles on his own. And that's the whole game. My biggest gripe with this is that it's just not really that engaging, and it's very tedious. You're essentially teaching the game how to play itself, and honestly, I'd rather play the game myself. I did play it for a little over an hour, and I wasn't really able to make much progress, and to be honest, the game really didn't do enough for me to want to keep trying. It is cool that the game was released in English, but it's still hard to recommend unless you're really into AI stuff, I guess. 2 stars. Okay, next up we have Planet Laika, which is a sci-fi RPG developed by Zequer. In this game, you play as Laika, an astronaut with multiple personality disorder and...
Oh no...
So yeah, every character in this game has a dog face. And while in the beginning it appears to be a very confusing design choice, it turns out it's actually a crucial part of the story. A long time ago, when the Martians inhabited Mars, humans made contact with them and transferred their faces to the Martians as a sign of peace? Who the fuck wrote this? The humans who lost their faces through this process were given dog faces, and shortly after, the Martians were wiped out entirely, and the planet emitted a dark energy called Evil Mind. Fast forward, and the Earth sends a crew to negotiate terraforming the planet, but they mysteriously vanish, and there are rumors of strange things happening on Mars, like the residents experiencing hallucinations and monsters appearing. So on Christmas, they decide to send a second team, your team, to investigate the face of Mars. And the exact same thing happens again. It's a very unusual concept, but I have to say, it piqued my interest, and I really liked the vibe of the game. You run around on these pre-rendered backgrounds like in Resident Evil, and there are a lot of people to interact with on Mars. The atmosphere is pretty nice, and the main gimmick of the game is that each NPC has an aura with a corresponding personality type. Red characters are animalistic and aggressive, blue characters are psychotic, and the yellow ones are visual. Each of these auras correspond to one of Laika's multiple personalities, and whenever you speak to specific NPCs, it'll raise your meter in that specific character. So when the meter is full with one specific type, you can transform into that character and use it to solve problems or enter battles. And the battle system is actually pretty unique in this game. Instead of a typical turn-based system like in Final Fantasy, you play Space Pong and have to reflect the enemy's attacks back at them. You can't really control where your blue orb thingy is though, and you can only speed it up or slow it down as it moves forward. It's a little janky, and it doesn't really work all the time, but I thought it was neat. Aside from that, it's a pretty standard RPG with a lot of heavy dialogue, although the pre-rendered backgrounds can make it kinda hard to tell whether an object is interactive or not, so you might get lost occasionally. However, I still enjoyed it, and I think if you're looking for a unique RPG experience, this definitely delivers. And while it was never released outside Japan, there is a fan-made English patch for the game, which is what I used, so I definitely recommend giving this one a try. The last weird game we're going to be looking at is Kowloon's Gate, which was developed by the same people who made Planet Laika, Zequer. This adventure game is considered a cult classic in Japan, and it takes place in the walled city of Kowloon, which was a hip, cool place in Hong Kong where you could do all sorts of fun things like avoid paying taxes and buy dog meat. The city was fully demolished in 1994, and the game takes place 3 years after the fact, when suddenly Kowloon mysteriously reappears in Hong Kong. According to a group known as the Hong Kong Supreme Feng Shui Conference, this re-emergence is supposedly due to an imbalance in the world's yin and yang. So you, the player, are a super feng shui magic person who is sent to investigate the problem and restore balance. Which is definitely an interesting premise. The game is divided into two major sections. The so-called JPEG dungeons, which are FMV sequences where you navigate the overworld and talk to NPCs to gather information and advance the story, and real-time dungeons, where you can freely move around in a 3D environment and fight enemies. The first thing you'll notice about the JPEG dungeons is that they look like absolute trash. Yeah, this is unfortunately one of the issues with FMV sequences on modern hardware. Even if you use a totally real and legitimately obtained PS1 like I did, you can't upscale a pre-rendered video because it's pre-rendered, so it's gonna look really dated no matter what you do. And it's a shame too, because atmospherically, it's a really cool game. The sound design is also super eerie, and the characters all look really weird. It's pretty cool. The game definitely has an interesting, surreal aesthetic, and I was really starting to get into it. However, gameplay-wise, you'd think it'd be pretty straightforward and easy to navigate since you just choose a direction and wait for the game to automatically move you forward, but it's not. The button inputs are slow and sometimes just completely unresponsive, and sometimes the on-screen directions just straight up don't match where your character actually goes. This can get really confusing, and you'll probably have to backtrack quite a lot. And every time you move, you have to watch the slow animation of the camera moving, and it gets pretty tedious even after just a few minutes. Luckily though, I was able to use a cool setting on my PS1 and fast forward through these sequences. It'd be pretty unbearable without it. There are also instances where you'll need to get an item to progress, but the guy you're supposed to get the item from doesn't actually give it to you unless you interact with him more than once. So you could talk to everybody in the entire city and still not be able to make any progress at all because you forgot to press somebody about the item you want. I'm sure this would be more clear too if there wasn't this big language barrier, obviously, but even then, I feel like it's a weird and kind of unnecessary design choice. The real-time dungeons, on the other hand, are a little better graphically and you can move around freely, but the controls are really clunky here too, and you can't turn while walking, so you'll constantly have to stop and adjust yourself every couple steps. As for the dungeon itself, it's pretty empty. There are enemies, but you can't actually see them in the game. Instead, it's like Pokemon or Mega Man Battle Network, where if you step on a certain space, you'll trigger an enemy encounter and then be brought into a battle sequence. The combat is pretty straightforward. You can attack, use items, or run away. But I feel like these dungeons were just a huge waste of potential. I mean, it's an adventure game, yeah, but honestly, I think the developers should have pivoted and made this into a horror game. I mean, all the groundwork is there, and they could have easily made this game super terrifying. I mean, look at these characters, it's horrible. But instead, the game just feels empty and repetitive and clunky, so it's really not that memorable. There was a PSVR prequel released in 2017 though, and according to the developer's website, it's a new, non-game VR experience, so you know it must be good. Overall though, the concept is pretty cool, but the game itself, it's just not really engaging, and I can't confidently recommend it to anybody. It's like Shenmue, but even slower and with less gameplay. I'm gonna give this one 2.5 stars. That wraps up our adventure into these bizarre PlayStation 1 games from Japan. I'm happy that I could actually get the games I asked for this year, that was nice, and while I wouldn't say all of them were fun, I do think we found some neat little gems in there. So hopefully you enjoyed learning about these games with me, and if you did, leave a like and don't forget to subscribe to my channel for more videos. Let me know in the comments section what your favorite PS1 games are, and I'll see you in the next video. Have a good one.